My name is Rick Lampe. I'm a biology professor here. I've been around a long time. The other side of me that you probably don't know a whole lot about is that I was a freshman here, and I'll leave it to you to figure out how many years ago. I went through Buena Vista, went off and graduated, and came back to teach, and it's been a really nice time. What we're going to do tonight is a few of us have gotten together to tell you some things about the history of the institution, about various aspects of the institution that maybe you've heard about, but maybe you haven't heard about, and to teach you some other things. We're going to have a good time tonight. We ask you to have a good time tonight. It's history as well as spirit. And the spirit of the place is what we hope you also can absorb. If you can't get into the institution and learn about it and absorb it, it doesn't become your place. We want Buena Vista to be your place. And so we've drawn this together, and we hope that you enjoy it. I'm going to introduce Chuck Offenberger, who's new on our faculty here, and Carl Offenberger, and take it away, Chuck.
Thank you, Rick Lampe. Well, Rick told you that he has been here decades as a student and now as a faculty member, and by comparison, I've been here about 10 minutes because my wife, Carla, and I just joined the faculty and staff this summer, so we're here for our first school year now, like a lot of you are. But Rick and I and Carla do share a real love for this place that is known as the spot that's by the beauteous Lake Resplendent. That's a line from the alma mater that we're all going to be singing here a little bit later. I do know a little bit more about the university than you might guess just from the short time we've been here. In 1975, I was just starting my career as a roving reporter and eventually a columnist for the Des Moines Register. I was traveling all over Iowa, and I found out that my favorite high school English teacher from Shenandoah down in the southwest corner of the state had landed here on the faculty at Buena Vista as a professor of English, Carl Adkins. He spent the rest of his career here, so in about 1975, when I'd get up to Northwest Iowa, I'd stop in and say hello, and I'd walk around this campus, and it was a beautiful place then, as it, even more so now, but I've been watching it all that time over these years. BV, in 1975, when I first saw it, was a far different, far smaller college that was still often struggling financially, even in those times. It was before the big $18 million gift, that huge $18 million gift from Harold Walter Stevens in 1979-1980 that forever changed this institution. But the more I hung out here, the more details I learned about the BV history. And I want to give you just a few highlights here, and this will be the driest part of the show, so we'll get this over with early and get into the fun. But I think it will give you a grounding so you can answer a lot of those questions that your family will ask you about this place when you go home on breaks. The best source of all this, if you're real serious about the history of this, is this book, History of Buena Vista College. It was written by Professor Bill Cumberland, a retired professor of history here. He wrote it in 1966. Then he revised it and reissued it for the college's centennial in 1991. It's fun and often amazing reading. I read it in 1994 for the first time, because that's when our son Andy was getting ready to start school here, start as a freshman at BV, and then he graduated in 1998. I read it again last spring when Carla and I were getting ready to come up here again and join the faculty and staff. Some particularly important points, I think, about the history of this place. First of all, it was founded in 1891. It evolved from a prep school that had operated since 1885 in Fort Dodge. Earlier than that, the Presbytery, which is the regional governing board of the Presbyterian Church, had decided it wanted to start, quote, a stable Christian college in western Iowa somewhere. Fort Dodge had won a spirited bidding contest over the towns of Cherokee and Calliope. Calliope later became Haywarden. So the prep school operated in Fort Dodge for 5 years, and it was always struggling financially. When the community leaders there began losing their enthusiasm for pouring more and more money into the school to support it, the Presbytery began looking elsewhere. And here came the 20-year-old town, frontier town of Storm Lake, in to put a bid on moving the school here. They made an offer to the headmaster, whose name was Reverend Loyal Y. Hayes, to bring the school to the Lake Shore and turn it into a liberal arts college, and he would be its first president. A key factor in Reverend Hayes' decision to move the school here was that, unlike Fort Dodge, Storm Lake had no saloons, according to Professor Cumberland's history. That remained a bragging point of this college for years to come. So on July 9, 1891, in a law office in downtown Storm Lake, the deal was sealed that brought Buena Vista College to Storm Lake. The town, to get it here, donated 8 acres of land, right here, and agreed to erect buildings with a total value of $25,000. School began with 4 students in the college course, and the first liberal arts degree was awarded in 1893 to Jenny Gordon Hutchison of Cherokee. From the get-go, the college's purpose, often used as its motto and now its mission, has been the same: education for service. In the early years, we were educating the pastors, the teachers, and the business leaders who built Northwest Iowa. And now, 108 years later, we're still doing that same thing. And I think this is the key thing for you to know about BV history, from that founding into the 1970s, from the founding on into the 1970s, is this: that the college was often teetering financially. You heard Don Lamberti on Saturday. He's the chairman of the Board of Trust here. He's also the chairman of Casey's General Stores. I think you heard him at that opening convocation tell how in the 1930s, there was a time when the college had 29 cents in the bank and $300,000 in debts. And the Great Depression was raging so hard that students were paying their tuition and fees with eggs and vegetables and other produce from home. And the same produce was used to pay the faculty and staff then. Things got better, and then bad again, and better again, and bad again for decades. President Moore told you on Saturday that one of the most pivotal times in the college's history occurred just after 10 p.m. on September 27, 1956, when historic Old Main, the nerve center of BVC, was destroyed by fire. You'll hear the story of BV's finest moment, which was the recovery from that devastating fire, told in a beautiful video as the grand finale of our program here this evening. In the late 1970s, President Keith Briscoe learned that a man named Harold Walter Stevens might be interested in helping the college. Stevens was a St. Louis native who, as a boy, had often visited relatives here in Storm Lake and had the fondest memories of this place. He had gone on to make a fortune in oil and gasoline exploration and leasing, mainly in Canada, but with operations all over the world. And he was looking for a good place to invest his fortune. He thought of a little college in Storm Lake, and thank God he did. His $18 million gift in 1979 was at the time the largest gift on a per capita student basis in the history of higher education in the United States. Staggering gift, and it forever changed this school. There are now twice as many students and twice as many buildings on the Storm Lake campus as there were in the 1970s. We have two of the most admired college buildings in the Midwest, in our underground Stevens Forum and in the Information Technology Center, which most of you will call a library. And the university is now one of the most financially secure in the Midwest. So that's our history, told scandalously brief, but it gives you a general idea, I think, of what's happened before you arrive at Buena Vista. Let me tell you one other observation I've had about this place, and this is what I told our son Andy when he was getting ready to go to school here in 1994. I said, well, Andy, I've done a lot of travel around the state, and I have met BV alumni in all walks of life all over this state and beyond. And I said, there's two things that I've noticed that they all have in common. One is they all seem to be doing pretty well for themselves in life. And the second one is they all seem happy. And once I got here and began to see what this place is all about, I know why that happened. It's a cool place to go to school. And we're going to be proud to share its story with you the rest of the evening. And now, Professor Landy, I'm going to bring you back up here to take us through some of the big changes over the years.
Thanks, Chuck. We thought what might be kind of fun is the comparisons, historic comparisons, from the beginning of the institution until now. So Carla's going to help me as we go through this. We've set up to look at tuition, room, and board on three different occasions, 1910, 1962, and 1999. If you look at 1910, look at the semester tuition. $3 a week for single room and board, $1.25 if you had a double. In 1962, now this is by semester, $375 for a semester, $130 for room, $225 for board. And our comprehensive fee right now has jumped. However, if you were to go back and put on a basis what the tuition was to other important things in life, a house, a car, land values, the institutional cost for college today isn't really that much different than what it was before. Look at the next one. We thought you might get a kick out of looking at some of the course requirements that were around here, again at the same time. In 1910, there was a heavy, the heritage of the institution was tied very, very closely to the Presbyterian Church. And so the study of the Bible was required in all schools of study for at least 2 years. In 1962, there was required chapel attendance. Now the chapel that stands up at the head of the lawn out here was present when I was a freshman. And we would go to chapel twice a week, Tuesday and Thursday at 10 o'clock. One day was a convocation, one day was a chapel. You had to be there. There would be someone that would come down the aisle and mark you absent, and you got two cuts per semester, two for chapel, two for convocation, so you could miss four times during the semester. Beyond that, it was $2 a cut. My roommate, when I was a sophomore, simply wrote him out a check at the beginning of the semester and handed it to them. He wasn't going to go at all. We gave up compulsory chapel attendance in the early 70s. But I hope that there's still the sense that as you come to an institution of higher learning, that there is some thought given to mind, body, and spirit. Our four core requirements right now are these, and certainly they're the ones that you're experiencing as you go through. And they have always been important to us. Liberal learning, but now learning that's applied to an experience that will lead you on through life. Let's look at some of the campus rules. Now this is the one that Chuck talked about at the beginning. No saloons or kindred dens. If you look down, it is free from saloons and kindred dens. And shortly thereafter, evil influences. The town is free from saloons and other evil influences. So it was a safe place to send your son or daughter to go to school. In 1962, the use of alcoholic beverages and the participation in games of chance or gambling by any student is cause for dismissal from the college. When I was a freshman here in 1965, the men and women residence halls were kept very much apart. But somehow, there was a keg party in the south end of Swope Hall. The problem was, they weren't very secretive about it. Now, I don't know how you can possibly keep a keg a secret, but this one certainly became well known, and about 25 people got expelled. If you had any alcohol on campus, you got expelled. We went from that situation to one in the late 70s, when the drinking age came down to 18. Students were permitted, almost all students, because all college-age students would be above 18. Alcohol was served in the Centennial Room. And still today, if we look at our drinking policy now, those who are of legal drinking age may consume on the campus. But certainly, we hope that you do so in an adult manner. Chuck, turn it back to you.
Well, besides teaching journalism, I'm also advisor to the TAC, so I'm particularly proud of this next story we're going to share with you. We have a historically interesting newspaper here, the first edition of which is going to come out tomorrow, and I want to introduce to you the editors of the TAC. We're going to tell you the story about how this newspaper got its name. Leah Haberhals and Kristen Nivey. Leah, they're both juniors, right? Yeah. Both juniors. Leah's from Hudson, South Dakota, and Krista is from Blairsburg, Iowa. Welcome.
Hi, everybody. You having fun tonight? Yeah, okay. Okay, just a second minute. The first edition of UP's weekly newspaper, The TAC, comes out tomorrow, Friday, and you'll be reading one of the oldest college newspapers in the Midwest.
It goes back to almost to the founding of BBU in 1891. It's been called The TAC since 1895, and under that name, you'll see the additional line, the newspaper with a point. Earlier names were The Commercial Review and The College Yeah. But the real forerunner of the TAC was the newspaper published by a student literary society, the Philomathians.
And from Professor William Cumberland's 1991 book, The History of Buena Vista College, that it appears a true story of how the paper got the name it still uses today.
It was not called the TAC until in January of 1895, when an exceptionally good paper was produced. In the course of the preparation of it, a box of tacks was accidentally upset and spilled. Get our point?
All right. Be sure to pick up our newspaper tomorrow. It'll be at the info desk about noon. And if you're interested in joining the TAC, you can write email to tac@ubu.edu or talk to one of us. All right? We'll need all of you to help out if you can. Thanks.
Thank you, Chris and Liam. We're going to head out of here tonight to go put the TAC together a little later on. Univista has also had a strong tradition in music and the fine arts, and here to tell us a little bit about that portion of our history is our new vocal music professor, Paula Keeler. Paula?
Hi. If you're a first-year student and feeling really new around here, let me tell you that we in the music department are starting fresh, too. I'm the new vocal director, coming here from directing at East High School in Sioux City for a number of years. And I don't know how your first week has been, but mine has been pretty wonderful. So I'm smiling a lot tonight. We also have a new vocal director this year, Jerry Bertrand. He comes from Marcus Meredith and Claiborne High School State Championship bands for 23 years. With help from our experienced support faculty, several of whom have been here for years, we're going to be doing our best to continue a grand tradition of musical performance and education at Buena Vista. Anyone who's been in music very long in Northwest Iowa knows the name of Bill Green, who from 1950 to 1975 was the director of BB band programs and made it one of the best small college programs in the United States. He is shown in the photo behind me with Dr. Merle Evans, who was the internationally famous director of the Ringling Brothers, Barnum and Bailey Circus Band, on what might have been one of the finest musical moments in BB history. That was on homecoming weekend in 1975, when Bill Green was retiring. Dr. Evans, who was one of Green's heroes, was invited here as a special guest conductor of the musical extravaganza that had 52 high school marching bands parading down Main Street in Storm Lake in a salute to Director Green. The BB choirs have also had directors who are widely respected. Most notably, Robert Flatcraft, who was in charge for 25 years, from the 60s into the 70s and 80s, and my immediate predecessor, Stan Meshoy, also had highly respected choirs. He and Dr. Chaz Moore, who was the band director in recent years, both retired last spring. You've seen here what music performance rooms looked like years ago, almost parlor-like. I invite you to come over to Edson Hall in coming weeks and see what kind of practice facilities we have now. After a recent total remake of the department, we have the latest in rehearsal rooms, most of them equipped with pianos, but fine for voice and instruments as well. And the neatest feature is that all are computer-controlled acoustical capabilities. If you want to hear what you'd sound like singing in Carnegie Hall, or a basketball arena, or an opera house, we can dial in a few changes and duplicate those acoustical conditions. The university also has had a wonderful tradition in theater, and I'm sure we'll get to enjoy that this year. The art professors, Dennis Dykema, a painter, and Mac Hornecker, a sculptor, are two of the best known, most widely collected artists in the Midwest, with works shown in galleries, corporate headquarters, and private collections all over the region. So you can see the fine arts are alive at BB. We invite you to come and join us as students and participants or enthusiastic members of our audience. We do hope that you'll share with us this year. We're having a great time. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Carla Keeler. Let's talk sports. Buena Vista has had a proud history in all kinds of sports, and here to give us the update on that is another new member of the faculty and staff here, our new athletic director. Let's welcome her, Jan Travis. Jan?
Thank you. Well, Paul and Jerry in music may think that you're new here on campus, but it seems like you seem like a veteran to me in that I've been here like 2 weeks and I'm still trying to find my way around and so forth. But sports began at BB soon after its founding in 1891 with baseball. And by the late 1890s, football was added. Our 1898 team won all three of its games. It was not unusual in those years for our teams to play against high school teams from the area or even against teams of railroad workers who were laying track through the newly opened frontier. We had one of our earliest women's basketball teams in 1910. As you are seeing in the photo behind me, both then, earliest women's basketball team in 1910, and as you're seeing in the photo, lost the contact there, can't really see. But then women's sports faded until the 1960s and 70s. Men's basketball started about 1917, according to Professor Chamberlain's history. Our teams were nicknamed the Beavers in 1921. Some have said that Des Moines Register headline writers came up with the name instead of always using Beavers to identify us, but the official history credits a student here, Carl Nicholas, with coming up with the nickname. Through the years, we have had a lot of great teams, coached by such legendary figures as Jim Kelly in football in the 20s, Jay Beckman in baseball in the 50s, 60s, and 70s, and Jim Hershberger in football in the 70s and 80s. Harriet Henry, who restarted the women's intercollegiate sports program in the early 70s. John Naughton in women's basketball in the 70s and 80s. Al Baxter, which you will still see around campus in wrestling in the 80s and 90s. And Marge Willardson in softball from the 81s since the present time. There have been many conference championships. The 97-98 basketball season is one we won't soon forget. Both the women's and men's BB teams won the Iowa Conference title. But the pinnacle of the athletic achievement so far has been the softball team's NCAA National Championship in 1984. The only national title in the history of BB. How many softball players do we have in here? All right, one. We have produced All-Americans and individual national champions in several sports. We have produced two Major League Baseball players. One of our most honored athletes in our college career was Jeannie DeMars, now Henningsen, who was an All-American in both softball and basketball in the middle 80s. She won the Iowa Conference Basketball Scoring Championship as a freshman, and by the time her 4 years were finished, her 3,171 points were the most scored by a female athlete at any level of collegiate competition. She broke 20 school records. When her athlete career ended, the whole college celebrated Jean DeMars Day on campus, an honor never accorded to another athlete here. And just last summer, the NCAA again recognized Henningsen, who is now a teacher in Alta, naming her to the GTE Academic All-American Hall of Fame. And I might add, in that Hall of Fame, there are only two Division III athletes, and we have one of them. It's quite an accomplishment. All of them are Division I or II players. At least three of our sports this fall are expected to challenge for conference championships. And should Coach Joe Hadachek and the Beavers football team claim the title, it will be the first since 1973. And I invite all of you to come. Saturday is our first football game. It's a conference game, and we're going to start out the season with a conference win. We're very proud of the fact that about 50% of our student body here on the Storm Lake campus participate in intercollegiate sports, and a whole lot more of you compete in intramurals. We think that our sports program will be a fun, inspiring, and important part of your education here at BB. Before you come Saturday, though, we invite you to attend our first volleyball game, which will be Friday evening that begins at 6 o'clock.
Ben, thank you very much, and welcome to the long-standing, successful athletic tradition we have here at BB. Nice to have you here. I'm going to ask our cheerleaders to come up, because I'm going to read a piece out of the Cumberland history, and they're going to help me with it. We have Alicia Ehlers and Jackie Vogt. Now, oftentimes, when you think about the history of an institution, and you think about cheers, you often think of those cheers being associated with athletic activity. I'll read you a piece. This comes from the 1890s. The enthusiasm of the student body was manifest in the wholehearted support given to the oratorical contests. Already during the 1890s, Buena Vista's traditional interest in forensics was developing. An oratorical contest during the winter of 1895 was called the greatest event of the college year. The contest became an annual event, and Buena Vista became a member of the Oratorical Association of the Colleges of Northwest Iowa. In a spirited contest held on May 15, 1896 at Sac City, Buena Vista emerged the victor. The rivalry between Buena Vistans and the institute that then existed at Denison was intense. The Pilot Tribune reported that Buena Vista had the best speaker in Willis Edson. You go out, the music hall that's right out here is Edson Hall. That's the family that this man had come from. And his oration on President Lincoln carried away first honors. Bad weather kept some Storm Lakers at home, but still the college outshouted their rivals by singing and giving the college cheer. Are you ready? Rick-a-chick-a-boo, rick-a-chick-a-boo, rick-a-chick-a, rick-a-chick-a, boom, boom, boom. Hoopla ha, hoopla he, hoopla, hoopla, BBC. Don't you just wish you could have been there? Thank you very much. We're going to go through some more of the history of BB. That's the mascot. Believe it or not, I think it's meant to look like a beaver, but I'm not quite sure. It was rather rodent-like in any of them. And that has changed over the years, the beavers. This was one of the favorite activities at that time. As I said earlier, men and women had separate residential halls. And on this occasion, you see some guys. No, I am not in that picture. You see some guys leaving Swole Paul. Now, before we leave that picture, this portion over here, the area right here, which you can still recognize as the entrance into Swole Paul, used to be called the Fishbowl. One of the rules that existed at that time was that all female students, all women students, had hours. 10:30 on weeknights, 1 o'clock on Friday and Saturday, and 12 o'clock on Sunday. All women, when they left the residence hall after the evening meal, had to check out. There was a sign-in up here. You signed out as you left the residence hall. Now, this is 1965. When you came back in, of course, you didn't want to get in any earlier than you had to. So everybody stood around down here waiting for that last kiss. So it was a glass-walled entrance, so it was a great big fishbowl. That place would be filled with couples And then Mrs. Montgomery would come down the stairs here and flick the lights and chase all the men out and herd the women upstairs to get them signed in. Should we do that again? Okay, on to the next one. The Beaver Den was at various places. It started out in the basement of Swope Hall, and then it moved to the basement of Loggie. Loggie was the student union cafeteria. The cafeteria was upstairs. The Beaver Den was downstairs. And then with the construction of the forum, it moved over here. Freshman Beans. Ah, yes. There are several vintage beans up here. All freshmen, when they arrived on campus, were given a bean. And you had to put it on, and you had to wear it all the time. You wore it in class, you wore it all over campus, you wore it uptown. You hated that bloody bean. And an upperclassman, anytime they wanted to, would approach you, and they'd say, "Button, freshman." That meant you had to take one hand. Now you're going to class, you're hurrying to class, and this upperclassman stops you and says, "Button." You have to be respectful, and you stand and you face them, and you put one hand on top of your head and you bow. Now, if they didn't think you were respectful enough, they'd say, "Double button." That meant you had to put both hands on top of your head and bow. And of course, the worst case was a triple button, the fearful triple button. You had to get down on your knees. I didn't have to do that too often. Now you're sitting there saying, "Yeah, right. They never get me to do this." Well, if you didn't button, there was a kangaroo court held out on the chapel lawn Friday afternoon. The Letterman's Club ran it, along with Student Senate. And the names of all the violators were called out. And they'd come and find you. They'd go all over to find you, and they'd bring you in, kicking and screaming, and then make you do all kinds of ridiculous things. The favorite, of course, was dunking in a horse tank. They'd just drop you in a horse tank. So you learned to button. Now you wore this beanie until homecoming. If you won the homecoming game, if the football team won the homecoming game, you got to take it off. If you didn't win the homecoming game, you had to wear it till Thanksgiving. Believe me, we cheered. And there are different beanies out here, different color combinations. Blue and gold was from my era. I think this was a recent one, and I think these were quite a bit older then. SOS Squad certainly has been popular and extremely helpful as students arrive on campus and move in. And this is a fairly new group. I don't know how much farther back it goes than this. We know it was here in 1972. But if any of you participate, I hope that you are duly thanked by freshmen as they move in. Student organizations, certainly student government, student senate, always been a part of the institution. And now we come to the Old Main story. Old Main was the main campus building. You see it here in this photo, probably from the turn of the century. I had a great uncle that was here in 1909, and my mother was here in 1929. So the stories that you were told about pain in produce are stories that I grew up with. My mother, as a two-year student here in education, her father paid by bringing pigs. The building, just go back one more minute, Carla. Just point out the arch, and you're going to hear more about this later, but that's the limestone arch that will be featured in the video at the end. Now let's go look at the map. This is the campus, about the time that the field house was under construction. So I think we decided the other night it was around 72 or 74, is that about right? Anyway, the thing to point out to you, look at the streets and the houses. First of all, can you see the campus? Not too easily. There are many houses all the way around, up in through here, down this street,
That's the science building right now. There was a street, Third Street, went right through the campus. There was a street that went right back here. There were tennis courts where the trees are now planted outside the windows of the Forum. All these houses were purchased, and this was all cleared out for the parking lot. I think those are the significant changes that we see here in this map. Let's go on to the next one. And certainly the old main story, we're going to let the video actually tell itself. It was rebuilt several different places. You'll see the Victory Arch here, and I think that's also indicated in the video. And this is the arch that you went through. And again, the limestone that was taken out of the old main entrance and rebuilt several places on campus. I think it's time, Carla, for you to introduce the challenge.
There's so much Univista history that we decided we can't tell it all to you in an hour. We're going to try to make this program. So we have a Buena Vista History Challenge, and we're calling it the Scavenger Hunt. And when you leave tonight, the ACES staff, which are in the green and white striped shirts, will hand you a gold sheet of history scavenger hunt questions. There's 15 questions, and here's the challenge to you. You can do this as a group, you can do it individually, and if you turn it back to me by September 10th, which is the week from tomorrow, Friday, September 10th, with the correct answers to the questions, which you can find in a variety of places around campus, we will put all the completed scavenger hunt quizzes into a drawing, and we'll draw a winner out, and we'll buy you a pizza party for 10. So you can take one, you can take as many as you want, you can share them, you can do it by yourself, you can do it as a group. There's 15 questions. You can find all the answers on campus. That's our history challenge for you. It's the History Scavenger Hunt. And now we're going to get to the history, the spirit of the institution with Chuck and Dr. Lamb.
Well, we're going to need the help from the cheerleaders again as we get into this portion of the show. So Daddy Hood and Alicia Ehlers, could you please come back up. Among the great traditions in sports and spirit here, we honestly have one of the coolest cheers any college anywhere does. It's called the Beaver Train. And we're all going to show it to you here tonight. And it's one you'll all be doing at the game. And when student body does this at games, everybody gets up and does it. It's a fun one. It's real easy to pick up. And so Jackie and Alicia, let's show them the Beaver Train, OK?
Gotta get up. Everybody's got to get up.
Everybody's
got to get up.
Everybody's
got to get up. Do it with us. Turn sideways. This way.
Come on, guys. Ready?
B-E-A-V-E-R-S.
In 77, I think. And His widow still lives just off the campus, Adeline Green. She's 87 years old. The three of us went to see her about a week ago, so she could tell us about the fight song, about her husband's career, and she helped him here with the bands. And she said, oh yes, she'd be happy to help us with the fight song, because she had the original score, handwritten, the one her husband composed the song on, and she loaned it to us so we could get the music right and the words as he typed them up. We're hoping to persuade Adeline to turn that into the BB Archives, because it's really a wonderful piece of tradition. So, we want to teach you the official BB fight song. And Candy, do you want to play it through once so we can hear it? Then Rick and I are going to sing it. We are probably, until the group Monday night, we are probably the only two guys on campus that know the words to this song. But we'll sing it, and then, so you can hear it, and then we'll get you all up and we'll all sing it together. So Candy, let's hear it once on the piano.
Oh, time starting tomorrow and sing us any one of the three that you've learned tonight, you can get $5. Yeah, $5. So, you can do it in a group if you don't want to do it by yourself, or you can do it by yourself, and you can sing any one of the above. And we already have people coming up in line to sing it for Monday night, so we don't think it's going to last long. And cheerleaders, we want them to be able to sing that fight song Saturday at the football game. So if you need to bring your words again, then bring it. And if you find us at the football game and want to practice, we'll have our $50. Okay? That's the spirit challenge. We're going to end the program tonight with the Old Main Burning video. And when that's done, the program's over.
Let me just add that this video was done by Professor Paul Bowers in the School of Communication and Arts. It was done in 1996 to commemorate the 40th anniversary of the fire of Old Main. So that was the story on this video. And it's a real quick 13 minutes, just a great piece.
In the summer of 1954, Buena Vista College had reached a crossroads in the 60-year struggle for existence. Under the leadership of Henry Olson, president for 23 years, the college had finally shed the crippling debt that for long threatened the future. Enrollments were up, and two new buildings, the Men's Dorm and Edson Hall, had been recently constructed. Most importantly, the college had finally earned the crucial North Central accreditation. The future looked brighter than it had in decades. However, despite the upswing in Buena Vista's fortunes, it had become clear that in the modern age, survival alone was not enough to secure the future. The college needed to grow to remain healthy. This challenge greeted Jack and Ruth Ann Fisher as they came to Storm Lake to serve Buena Vista and to take the college into a new era. The college had few resources and fewer prospects, but Jack Fisher, the young, energetic, cigar-smoking president, brought a new vitality and hope that was difficult to resist. At that time, the main buildings on campus were few. Smith Hall served the science department, Edson Hall, or Victory Hall as it had been called, was the gym, and the new men's dorm, later to be named Pearson White Halls, housed the surging male student population, many returning veterans from the Korean conflict. Fracker Hall, a converted army barracks from World War II, served as the library, a far cry from today's newly completed Library and Information Technology Center. But undeniably, the center of campus was Old Main, the three-story stately Victorian structure that housed the administrative offices, most of the classrooms on campus, the chapel bookstore, theater, and music department. The three peaked roof and stone archway were the architectural beacons that drew everyone to its wooden floored halls, commanding a panoramic view of Storm Lake. Built in 1893, Old Main was the original campus building. Although the years had brought with it the edges of decay, for many, Old Main still represented the rock-solid foundation of the Buena Vista dream. But on the evening of September 27, 1956, the new hope Jack Fisher had brought to campus suddenly began to spiral away as smoke poured from the roof of Old Main. Within moments, fire engulfed the newly replaced roof.
At first, there was sheer amount of disbelief. No one wanted to believe it, first of all. And as I recall, when you looked out the window, you couldn't see that there was any action over there.
got closer and closer, we realized, of course, that it was all me. My mother was very devastated because she had very fond memories of having been a student here. And Old Main was the center of the entire campus.
Once the realization set in that the building was not going to be usable, it was then one of, well, what are we going to do? You know, I mean, we've got classes that are already scheduled and so forth. And then I think sort of a feeling of despair set in.
Fire trucks were called out from Elda, Newell, and Storm Lake. But no effort could quell the raging flames that consumed the roof and third floor. Meanwhile, groups of students ventured into the lower floors to salvage what they could of college records, valuables, and furniture.
I remember the lot of us streaked over to the building and started carrying things out. We carried things out as fast and furiously as we could, and the fire department sort of indicated that this was an old building, going to burn very fast, and we better get out of there, we better stay out. No one really wanted to believe that. We wanted to try and save as much as we could, and we kept going in until they made us stop.
If we hadn't had the boys' dorm, I think we'd lost everything, because the boys all came up and helped carry things out. And if they'd been scattered around town, they couldn't have gotten there in time to do any good. Jack had a brand new desk in his office that they had taken in, and they'd taken the top and screwed it on, and they put a glass top on. And that night they just carried the whole thing out at one time. It was just a little bit of paint on, and that was all. But, and I had $60,000 worth of bonds in my living room for a while in my wastebasket.
We had just bought the house that we're in. And about 2 years before, we were busy remodeling, so when I went to bed, I slept. And at that time, we still had the old fire whistle that would blow every time there was a fire. And we slept right through it. It was a nice evening, and the windows were all open. And not only that, the fire trucks from Newell came, and they went right up Lake Avenue. Our home was a half a block away and never even heard that. So I heard it the next morning on the radio.
My husband said that on the wall there were two shells. Everything else collapsed and fell down into the hole. But the Christian flag was standing on one shelf. The honor scroll was on the other. And he said, this is symbolic of where the university is going. He said, it's got to be a meaning someplace in that. And I truly believe that.
One of the symbolic things that was very meaningful to an awful lot of people was this Christian flag that blew outside the window and was stuck to the brick by the fireman's frame, and it survived the very intense heat. I don't know how, but it did. And it was there, and it was there the next morning. And I think that was a great symbolism of for a Christian college. And I guess if you talk about heroes, it would be the Board of Trustees and again, Jack Fisher's ability to bring us all together.
I remember the next day probably more vividly because the student body gathered around the flagpole that stood in front of Old Main. And we prayed with President Fisher and we sang the alma mater. And there was a real sense of family and almost like a family losing a loved one.
For many, it seemed like the burning of Old Main was the last straw in a futile struggle. That perhaps, after so many sacrifices and tribulations, trying to go forward from this devastating loss was simply too much to ask. Ultimately, the Bunivist dream seemed too vulnerable, too fragile. But that wasn't how Jack Fisher and the college administration saw things.
President Fisher announced that classes would be held as usual the next day. That gave everybody there a considerable list.
I think that the leadership under Jack Fisher had a lot to do with it. When he came to this campus, he was a young, dynamic man that announced at the very beginning of school that by the end of the 9 months, he would be able to speak to every student by the student's first name. So you know he was dedicated to BBU. And he had this power and this desire to see that BBU lived. And it could have been the turning point where we died. But he was full of energy, and I think that Ruth was right there at his side helping. So, in fact, I think the whole town rallied around.
One thing that I remember is a couple of weeks later was homecoming, and it was probably the best homecoming we've ever had. Everybody was talking about school spirit. It certainly was there, and it was evident to everyone within the college community as well as the community of Storm Lake. It was probably one of the best parades we've ever had, and the winning float that year was a white dove rising out of ashes, and I can't remember exactly what it said on the side, but there were not very many dry eyes as they watched the students show to the community that the spirit that we felt that under this would indeed raise from the ashes. And of course they had no idea it would turn out to be what it is today, but we hoped.
Eventually, the college community rebuilt what had been lost, and because of the crucial moment, those closest to the Buena Vista dream did not turn away. Buena Vista College indeed rose from the ashes to become much more than anyone could possibly imagine. The stones from the cherished old main arch were recovered, along with the victory bell that hung atop the belfry. The arch was reconstructed as a gateway to the campus and as a reminder of the indomitable spirit that lives on in the new halls and classrooms that have replaced Old Main. Eventually, the stone arch, moved when 3rd Street was closed to make way for the spacious new forum, was reset into a massive brick monument that sits in the center of campus, the gateway through which all students pass twice, once upon arrival as a freshman, and again at graduation. The ritual twin processionals serve as a living reminder that we always pass from one gateway to another. Just as the passing of Old Main, as sad and tragic as it was simply the ending of one chapter and the beginning of another in the long journey towards something better, something much greater for the life of Buena Vista. In the 40 years since that blaze lit the autumn sky along the north shore of Storm Lake, the dream of education for service has burned only more brightly with each passing year, lighting the way for the hope and future for Buena Vista.
I think that's true of Old Main. We had to lose it in order